thinking about the coming of the Holy Spirit this morning, and there's some things that went on in my life early this morning that I thought that the Pentecost would be gone this morning on me. Amen? Because they said there was a violent wind, and I didn't have no wind, and I didn't have no tongues of fire, and I didn't know if I could speak this morning. But praise God, He's given me a chance one more time to proclaim the word. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Let something I'm saying this morning inflame people, enlighten them, grow that flame in their hearts. Take me out of self, God. Replace me and put me in the spirit that you need me to be. Let the words I say not be my words, but your words. And I ask all these things in your name and for your seed. Say amen. I have a song I like, and I can't sing it as well as the lady can sing, and I think I confused Brother Brady. But it's like this, it goes, Holy Spirit, fill this room. Shall come a glory, sweet perfume. We need your presence.
And what we hear wine. My servant is come, Holy Spirit. But my subtitle is, are you ready for the power of Pentecost? Some of us are sitting here and we go through this service every year about Pentecost. But we get fooled and put aside because we believe that Pentecost is only the people who run up and down the aisle, scream and carry on, and fall out and speak in some tongues that no one heard. And some of us are too sophisticated today to do that kind of stuff, amen? But I want to let you know that as Sister Cheryl said, the gift of Pentecost is for everybody. Amen. That those 40 days of waiting, those 50 days of waiting, as Pentecost means, that they waited to get together. So I want to tell you this, that the Pentecost power is not something that's just random and just comes whatever it feels like. It's because Jesus said that I'm going to leave, and I got to leave so that the Comforter can come. He says, when I leave, he says, I cannot, the Spirit can't come till Jesus was glorified. And once Jesus was glorified, then the Spirit came. Now sometimes we're confused and we think that the only people that was around for Pentecost was the 12. I hate to take it back from you, but there was 120 of them, amen? Amen. Those said that 120 was in the room. So therefore God has people and placement. Yeah. You see, in the Jewish, one of the Jewish traditions says that if you don't have 120, you don't have a congregation. I don't know, I better get one. So they said 120. But it didn't what it said. It said it was 120. It took 50 days. You see, the Holy Spirit could have came the minute Jesus went up and came back and they could have done it. But no, the Holy Spirit was always walking. Amen. Amen. So there had to be placement in order. But here's what I like. I think we need to go back into Scripture because some of us, we get thrown off by these, you know, these tongues and these winds and these rushing winds and all that sort of thing. But hear me. It says that they were all in one place. Amen. So that means that you've got to be on one place for the Holy Ghost to come together. You can't be out of there and be home talking about I'm coming to church and I feel like it, but I got the Holy Ghost. No. The Holy Ghost is manifest in community. So you may have the Holy Ghost, but let me help you with that too. It says the Holy Ghost went on everybody in the room. You know everybody wasn't saying. Because what did the guy say? He said, look, they had all spoke different languages and wanted to know how these people can talk to us because they were filled with the Holy Ghost. Not one of them had been to school yet. Amen. But they can speak another language. Amen. Sometimes we speak other languages, people don't know what we're saying, but we're speaking plain English. But here it is. That these people were speaking plain, speaking something, but it wasn't an unintelligible language, a language that everybody knew. That's because Jesus had told, look, when I leave, the Holy Spirit will come, and I'm going to give you power. So you just don't stay here at home. You're going to do Judea, Samaria, and around the world. Not just to stay in one place, amen? That the Holy Spirit power should be something that's right here, and I own the Holy Spirit. I walk around God, I'm Holy Spirit. Come on, Holy Spirit. I got the Holy Spirit. I ain't sharing it with you, but I got the Holy Spirit. Yeah, you got a whole lot of people that are blessed, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. And then you look at them, and they're evil the next minute. That you understand that the Holy Spirit is a joyful thing. Yeah. Why do you think 3,000 people would have joined those early people if they were evil? I got the Holy Spirit better than you. No. They came to the service. They came to that thing that day because they felt everybody shared together and smiled on people. Yeah. When you feel with the Holy Spirit, you're asked to do something different. Amen. Even so, it And see, a lot of us, we want the Holy Spirit to come when we want it to come. And leave, then come back. While we do all our devilment. Well, I'm in the Holy Spirit today, but I'm going to cuss you out on Monday at the job. The Holy Spirit today. And Tuesday, I'm mad because y'all didn't come back to work. You understand this? You want some time? Oh, you've been here too long, time. You go. You know what I mean. That's what, but somehow that's a man. Those are the main people who got the Holy Spirit. They won't even let anybody else. But you know something? One day you need to ask them, well, you got the Holy Spirit? You said you had the Holy Spirit. Well, show it to me. You don't have to speak it in a tongue. Your tongue can be like this. Hello, sister. How are you? I just give you a simple touch. I'm not going to go, ha! That might not be what feeds your soul. Amen? See, God said the Holy Spirit. So he gave each one of those people a part of the Holy Spirit. It's a gift of the Holy Spirit. If I feel the gift of the Holy Spirit, you feel the gift of the Holy Spirit. We all want to feel it. But where does it say it has to be? It has to be in community. Amen? Yes. Number two. Number three, it says that you got to be on one accord. Yeah. Now you see, a lot of us, we all got the Holy Spirit at our own corner. At our own corner. We ain't in one accord. So then, Brother Brady, can you play me a note? Now play me a chord. Okay. Okay, again, a note. And a chord. Hear what it is. You have a note, you just like this. Nope, 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 nope. I'm doing my thing. Hello, hello. But they're all separate. They all make it known separately. Amen? That's why we say when you have a chord, we need to be on one accord. Chord. Amen? Because it sounds better. It's all different though, right? There's a difference, but the differences are put together. And so when the God had those people up in that room, they would begin a whole community together. And they said, we're going to get together and we're going to spread the Holy Spirit. Because you know, it had me terrorizing. Yeah, Jesus died by yourself. But now you got to take that spirit of the Holy Spirit. And now you got to move forward. But I want you to know that we don't have a cord when I don't got the Holy Spirit. I hate to say so. Some of us, we think we want to have the Holy Spirit. But until we become on one accord, we're going to have a problem. Amen? Now, I don't know about you, but the Holy Spirit used to scare me. When I was a child back in the day, we had a lady that used to come to all our revivals. And she was a revival, you know, in those days, women weren't allowed to be pastors, but they could be evangelists, you know, they didn't have a church. And they could sit in the front. And so this big woman used to come every year. Sorry. She was big and she used to have this fox around her neck. You know, a dead fox, you know, with his head holding on to his tail. Around her neck, she had a big hat on her head. She would get the Holy Spirit all the time. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And I was scared of that woman. I had to sit behind her. And that animal was dead, but it kept looking at me. And I used to say, hallelujah! And she used to get, hallelujah! She'd fall out and throw that thing up and it flew on me and I don't know. Thing is, that's how we are sometimes. We scare people with the Holy Spirit. Amen? Because they don't have the Holy Spirit. But you know, the Holy Spirit is something that's given to everybody. And even though you may not speak in tongues, you may not fall out, you may not dance around the church and go on and run around the church, that might not be you. You can stay right in your seat and exhibit the Holy Spirit. Amen? And to descend on the group. Amen? That the power was for everybody. And it came. If you're not going to exercise the Holy Spirit power, then maybe you should just give it up because it's there for you to take. The power came into them, and they started speaking other tongues. Amen? That means they can speak Spanish and French and Creole, and they can do what they call, I forget, some of the other languages like Cree and all those kind of stuff. They can begin to say something. They're going to be able to open their mouth and do God and Fonte, those kind of languages. They can stand up and say those things because they have it in their spirit. I don't know how many of you in here feel that you can speak in the Holy Spirit. But I know you need to look at somebody and say, do you have the Holy Spirit? You better look around and say, do you have the Holy Spirit? Are you ready to take the Holy Spirit to the other people in the world? Are you ready to go get up in the morning and say, you know, I'm not going to fuss at nobody this morning. This morning I'm going to offer them Christ. Amen? And even if they don't speak your language, and you know, they may use the other language I call the cursing language, where there's an M and an F and an S and an F, and you know why, the B, and every sentence they make, and you don't speak to them because of that. Maybe if you talk to them with the power of the Holy Spirit, maybe they won't use that language anymore. Some people use that language because it gives them power over you. That's why I'm scared of all when they talk to me. I look at them like, really? They look at me like, well, you know, Baba's how I talk. I said, no, that's because you want to talk that way. But you know what I mean? I don't say they're wrong. I just say, hey, man, it's the only language they know. Our job is to give people another language. So the day of Pentecost, we're not just supposed to be there in the thing. And the day is the day that the church comes forward and becomes a church under God. You see, before there was no church. But now we have a church. Amen. Because God is a punishing God, they believe. And some people claim they only like Jesus because Jesus don't believe in the law. But I want you to know that the Holy Spirit and Jesus and God are three in one, the Trinity, amen? That makes us distinctive, makes us different than everybody else, that we can believe in three persons as one substance, amen? So again, we got to understand we got to do our job. We got to understand that inside there's got to be a heart on fire. John Wesley, we talked about him, but he was walking one day on the road, and they got a spirit in the altar's gate that says his heart was strangely warm. So even a man back in the 17th century could feel the heart of 17th, 18th century, could feel the spirit of the Lord upon his life. I want you to know this morning that we got to be in unison. We got to be together. We got to be on one accord, amen? Not nine accords. If you don't like, I'm not saying you have to be the same, but we need to take ourselves and put ourselves into a mosaic that fits together as one community of faith in God, Christ right here in this church. We got to do that in this church, and we got to spread it to the world. Yes. But we got to take my Holy Ghost power, and I got to join to Sister Cheryl's Holy Ghost power, and then she got to give it to Reverend Boyce, and we got to go to everybody's Holy Ghost care. That means we got to go and get together and say, we're going to put aside anything that's not of Christ. Amen. And we're going to sit down and say, we're going to agree to disagree, but we're going to agree that as long as we do things as in God's order, we're going to do it. Amen? Yeah. We gain more and more power when we, the people of God, unite for a cause.
Amen. Thank you.
The Holy Spirit will come when we do the work of God.
Yeah.
But you know, if individuals don't work together, then some of that power is lost. Amen? If you notice, many more people, a lot of people around the world work together for the good. I was looking at a show the other day about the Japanese. People may not know or don't remember that the Japanese was interned in America back in the day of the war, Japanese war. And they were forced to, they took them out of their homes, took them out, stole their homes, took their money, and put them on a reservation. Those people had to live together in a place where nobody wanted them, and they, some of them have been Americans for years, so they live with nothing. But you know, now they're one of the strongest groups there is in America. Some of the richest people in America, not because of Japan's birth now, but because of the time of adversity and challenges as we have in this church now, that they got together and said, we're going to be on one accord. I don't care if you come from Osaka or you came from the middle of Yokohama, you both want to get together. And we got, they got together even though they were Japanese because they were Japanese people. Yeah. They didn't care about their different languages. They didn't care they didn't like certain people. They united.
Amen.